Hi. Okay, we are back. It has been a little bit. For the past week, we have been dealing with some crazy things here at the house. Firstly, we needed to get some roofers in. Hold on, I'm gonna pull this back because it's in my way. We needed to get some roofers in. We had some roof damage with the high winds that we had recently. And then on top of that, during a massive storm, our sump pump died. Turns out the main one had been dead since we bought the house 6 years ago. And we've been running off the backup ever since. And when we had our homeowners inspection, nobody caught it. So that was just a delight. So we've been dealing with some like house stuff and different things. So we are back. We're gonna test out Seeking Sister Wife. I don't know how we're gonna feel about it. It leaves me with a lot of questions, and it seems like some rage bait, honestly. I don't know if I feel super connected to it yet. But we're gonna test it out, see what we think. I also have considered going back and reviewing the old show My Five Wives. I don't know if anybody remembers this show, but they came from the same church as the Brown family, but left before beginning filming. And frankly, I find them fascinating. And it was only 2 seasons, so we might go back and try that out too, just to see, because I think a lot of people have forgotten it even existed. But if you are new here, hi, I'm Cozy. I like to talk about reality TV here on YouTube. I do like to remind you these videos are for entertainment purposes only. These are not facts, just my opinions about public figures sharing their lives on television. Cool? Cool. Okay, so we're gonna jump in to Seeking Sister Wife. I don't know. I genuinely don't know. This show is weird. I'm gonna go family by family instead of going in order of what happened on the show because I think it's gonna be easier to follow, honestly. So we are gonna start with the, I believe it's Selah Houdin family. I think I could be incorrect. If I'm wrong, I will try to learn better. But it's Naeem and Nyla. And they're unpacking groceries, and they seem to have a lot of chemistry. They said they've been married for about 15 years. And Nyla introduces them as a plural family looking for their next wife. So they were both raised in Islam, and they both follow the traditional pillars of the religion. And polygamy is actually a traditional pillar of Islam. They said they didn't come to polygamy because of religion, but it did make it easier. So Nyla says their sister wife does not have to follow the same beliefs, but does have to believe in something and needs to be open and spiritual and honest. And she doesn't have to be beautiful as long as she's beautiful on the inside. Naeem says, I don't understand why you have to tell me what she has to be. So obviously we have a little bit of a disconnect here. And she lays a hand on him to quiet him down and says she has to be beautiful on the inside. Now, we've only met these people. This is obviously a difference of opinion. You could take it either way. You could take it as Nyla wants to be the pretty friend, if you will, or you could say she doesn't care about looks, she only cares about the soul of the person. We don't know her well enough to know which that is yet, so I'm not gonna like speculate too far, but I am holding that in the back of my mind to kind of wonder, what's going on there? They share that they've been practicing polygamy for about 2 years, and when asked whose idea it was, they say Nyla. She says they were married monogamously, but she noticed that Naeem thrives on love and support. So when she noticed how great he was with her love and support, she said she started wondering how great would he be if he had much more love and support from a whole nother person. She was like, initially it was about giving him that, but for me, it's about having a large, bustling family. She comes from a large family, and so that's what she would like. So they've begun dating Keisha, who lives in Georgia. And she and Keisha are pretty close. They talk every day. They haven't met in person yet. That's a little concerning, but they feel like she's special and she could be the sister wife for them. So Keisha's going to be visiting, and they have already talked this poor lady into meeting the whole family. That seems a little out of pocket to me, honestly, because they are aware. Nyla is very aware. Her mother-in-law is 100% against this. She does not think this is a good plan, and she is very nervous how this is going to go. So again, out of pocket to do this to Keisha. If you're already concerned about how this is going to be, you maybe shouldn't do this. But Naeem says he doesn't care what people think, and his mother arrives, and he doesn't think his mother's going to take this news very well. Very astute. They've been dating Keisha for a few months and they plan to move her to Pennsylvania. Now, I have lived in Florida. I have lived in Ohio. I will tell you right now, I will take Ohio over Florida any day of the week. I haven't lived in Georgia, but it's kind of nice in the Midwest. Just saying. Appalachia's not a terrible place. So he's like, I don't want to just drop this on my mom. And we're introduced to Jamayla. That's Naeem's mother. And she says Naeem is her third son. And Nyla's like, listen, we know that Jamayla's not cool with this. She doesn't know that we're specifically seeking another wife right now, but she is not cool with this. And she's like, I know he had a conversation with her to let her know we were considering it, but I don't know where that went. And so Jamayla's super honest when they bring it up. Because Nyla's like, so about that conversation you and Naeem had, what do you think? And Jamayla's like, I wouldn't do it. I wouldn't do it. She says, I'm picky, and it seems germy to me. And both of them really jump on that, and they're like, well, what do you mean? And Jamayla's like, really actually quite reasonably, honestly, I think she's being very reasonable, when she's like, well, everybody has their own germs, their own diseases, and I don't know that I want to bring that into somebody. You know, you're sharing, things get... They jump on that. Naeem gets way too aggressive. I mean, this is the first episode, and he's very aggressive with her. And he's like, you don't know anything. You don't know that people are dirty. People get tested, blah, 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 blah. He's like, you keep calling this nasty. And she's like, whoa, I'm not accusing anybody of anything. And he's like, yeah, you're calling people nasty. And she's like, nope. She keeps defending her opinion that it just is not for her. And she thinks sharing bodily fluids isn't great. That's fine. I think she's actually being really reasonable. She never raises her voice, really. She's just kind of trying to explain her position. So the couple throw out some different things that we've heard in Seeking Sister Right before about changing pH balances and everyone should be clean and blah, 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 blah. And Jamayla is very calm and she's like, this wouldn't be my choice. I've let you know that. I don't understand why you think you need my approval. And the couple's super heated. Like, we're adults. We don't need your approval. But you're fighting her for it. That's how this is coming across. Naeem's super offended that his mother thinks this is germy, and he's like, she's only worried about one thing. That is a thing to be worried about in this situation, I suppose. And Nyla's like, he's like, we're all adults and we'll be taking precautions. And Nyla's like, she's being super ignorant. Okay, that's fair if you think that. And she's like, how, Jamayla, how, if you brought Naeem up in Islam, do you not realize that this is part of it? And Jamayla's like, listen, I did realize it was part of it. It was never for me. I didn't want to do that. She's like, I never thought it would be part of my life. I love my son dearly, but this isn't my thing. She's like, he is overdoing it. And Naeem points out that it was Nyla who brought this up first, almost like he's trying to deflect and take some of the heat off of himself. And Jamayla says she's super surprised that Nyla, being so well-educated and well-versed, would be the one to bring this up. And Nyla's trying to explain to her how Naeem thrives on love, affection, affirmation. And she's like, I think it would benefit him. And Jamayla says, you need to go to the store and get some signs and books and decorate this place up. And he's like, and they're like, what? She's like, y'all need therapy. Okay. Now we have stepped into the realm of maybe a little bit of attacking. And Nyla's like, I think you're being very judgmental. And I expected the opinion, not the judgment. But Jamayla rightly points out that her son is super defensive and nothing she says is going to be correct. And it devolves into a massive fight from there. And that's how they end it. And then we also met the Sherwood family. The Sherwoods are from Massachusetts, and that would be Shane and Ashley. They're going to be having their second baby, another little boy. They've been together for 3 years and married for 2. They kind of been talking about adding another person for about 2.5 years, meaning prior to their marriage, they were already discussing this. Shane's like, we both feel we're not monogamous people, and Ashley backs it up saying it's unfair to expect one person to fulfill all your needs. And she acknowledges the majority of the world is fine with monogamy, and that's okay. They said they met through competitive axe throwing, which I didn't know was a thing. I knew axe throwing was a thing. Competitive axe throwing, I suppose I should have known, didn't know it was a thing. And they met through social media. And apparently when Shane first met Ashley in person, the first thing he said was, you're so much hotter in person, which is kind of cute. They began dating in 2020. They got married in 2021. A month later, she got pregnant with baby number 1, and now they are expecting baby number 2. Ashley says, well, dating while you're pregnant is like, what are you doing? And yeah, girl, honey, what are you doing? Ashley's clearly the mergers and acquisitions person in this family, as it appears she is the one doing the searching for another wife. This is kind of important. She wants the person to be a good fit and to be another mother for their babies. Ashley says the only hardline rule is accepting the children and being willing to have a biological child with Shane. They feel it's super duper important. Ashley's essentially dating the women, and Shane says, she says it's because she doesn't want to waste Shane's time. The woman she selected is the hair and makeup artist from their wedding. Little weird, but all right. They matched on a dating app a month ago, and Shane says that Ashley and Grace have been having these deep intellectual conversations about work and having children. And at this point, I'm going to get kind of concerned that Grace is more interested in Ashley and not in polygamy, and this is going to blow up in everybody's face. But Ashley says she's open to exploring things, and having another partner will make Shane happy. And maybe the right person comes along tomorrow, or maybe it is Grace. And Grace and Ashley are going bowling. And right off the bat, I notice these two are dressed very similarly. So they seem to be on a similar wavelength, or at least have similar tastes. So they have, Grace introduced herself. They said they've been on a few dates. And that they have, they've been on a few dates. And that it's been really lovely getting this friendship, allowing to have this connection. And Grace can't answer why she's open to polygamy. She can only say that she's open to connections wherever they might come from. So Ashley's like, the thing I like best about my connection with Grace is emotional intimacy, which is very important, obviously. And Grace says that dating someone who's pregnant doesn't feel any different. That's just something the female body can do. And so it, she says it kind of feels cool. So they discuss going skydiving once Ashley's no longer pregnant, and her phone rings. And she answers Shane's call, and Grace gets very quiet and kind of reserved. And the look on her face says that she's not really comfortable with this. And Ashley's like, I have to go home and relieve Shane. He's been doing baby duty all day. Ashley's really excited for Grace and Shane to meet because she hopes that Shane sees the same thing in Grace that Ashley sees in her. And it's at this point they find out they're not a typical plural family. Because all of the things that they've said before to make it sound like this is a second wife for Shane, not quite. Ashley's bisexual. And so the picture's becoming clearer. She's actually looking for a partner for herself, she says. And Shane playfully gets up to leave. And I'm very confused because I thought this seemed initially like it was going to be more mainstream polygamy, but it seems more like polyamory now, where everyone is expected to be each other's partner. But I'm still very confused because they're not being exceptionally clear right now what's happening. So when Ashley gets home to Shane doing the dishes, they're ready to discuss the date with Grace. And Shane says that there's benefits to sister wives. And the one that he points out is that everybody has fights and tiffs, and he has no sounding board to discuss Ashley. Why am I getting flashbacks of Cody and Robin Brown? Because this is a huge red flag to me. This should never be the purpose of a sister wife. The sister wife shouldn't be there to go running to somebody and be like, oh, well, Shane's really, really sorry. You should forgive him, which is exactly what Shane says he expects the sister wife to do. That's concerning to me. I don't think this is ever going to work out. I just don't. He also says that if something happened to him, it would put his mind at ease that Ashley had somebody who loved and cared for her. This is very much like, I'm going to die and I'm picking my partner's new partner before I go. Weird. But in the kitchen, Ashley says there's nothing new to report, and Shane keeps pushing because he wants to find out what's going on. He's like, you didn't get more flirty, there's nothing to tell me. And so Ashley's like, my family's very traditional. I didn't even accept my bisexuality until January of 2021. And she said, I had my first physical encounter with a woman in 2023. And so Shane's asking her about her attraction to Grace, and Ashley's like, she's gorgeous, but I don't know. And Shane's like, I have some feelings about potential jealousy. So Ashley's like, communication is there. It's the key to this. So there's nothing to be jealous about if you know exactly what's going on. And I disagree completely because I can be jealous about everything I know is going on. My husband goes to D&D once a month and I am jealous of his time and jealous that he gets to go out of the house and do something fun that I don't get to do. I'm jealous and I do know what's going on. And Ashley's like, listen, we kissed goodbye at the end of the date, but it was just kind of a basic goodbye kiss, sort of like how I kissed you when I came in the door. And they discuss how things are going, and Shane admits that his college girlfriend had come out as gay while they were still together, is the way that he made it sound. And he wondered if it was something about him. And so when Ashley came out, there had to be a lot of conversations because he had a lot of concerns. And Ashley admits that this is very confusing for her because she's so intellectually and emotionally attracted to Grace, but not necessarily physically. And she's at the point where Grace needs to meet Shane because she thinks that might be the disconnect. And Shane's like, did you guys talk about when Grace would want to meet me? And she's like, no. She flat out points out that none of their discussions have been about whether or not Grace is actually interested in meeting Shane. He gets a little bit miffed about it because he feels like they've discussed giant issues like how to co-parent and having more children and all of these things, but they haven't discussed meeting Shane. And he does seem upset that Grace doesn't have an interest in meeting him. And he gets concerns that Grace is more interested in Ashley and not being part of a larger unit. I don't think those concerns are unfounded. I'll just be honest. That's where we leave the Sherwood family. On to the Davis family. The Davis family is a returning family. They have three wives, and Nick. Now they have a new baby, Vera. And This is the family where the wives marry each other. So the first and second wife are legally married to one another. The third wife is legally married to no one. Nick marries no one. So April, Jennifer, and Danielle, in that order, are the first, second, third wife. Danielle is young. I believe she's 24, I think. I don't think they say it in this episode, but I believe she's 24. They live in Colorado, and like I said, they have baby Vera. And Nick certainly has a type because all three women are very similar. They are all blondes, and I believe they all have blue eyes or light-colored eyes. They are very similar women. So they're introducing themselves, and Danielle is clearly nervous because when they linger on her, and she's like, oh, am I supposed to say something? And they're like, yeah, introduce yourself. And so she introduces herself as the third wife. Nick says that he's sure something in his past contributed to his decision to live polygamy, and weirdly attributes it to the show Three's Company. Now, I have not seen enough of Three's Company, nor do I remember enough of Three's Company to really feel like that makes a lot of sense, but it doesn't make sense to me. Danielle, in a very early era sister wives move, tells us that the benefit to having a sister wife is having someone who understands you. Girlfriend, I've said it before, I will say it again. You do not have to share a man to have friends. You don't. The family is taking baby Vera out to go and buy a birthday present for her first birthday. And this baby is cute. Oh my gosh. She is just a little cuddle muffin. Oh my goodness. If I continue watching the show, it might just be because baby Vera is cute. Honestly, that's, she's so stinking cute. Just want to pinch her cheeks. So they're talking about how they think it's very beneficial that everyone's been there from the beginning. Baby Vera won't know any different. That she calls all of the babies mom already, which is kind of unsurprising because there comes a phase where where babies pretty much call all women mom. Like, I don't know that's all babies, but that happens. And so I have to say we have seen this before. Three blonde haired women, all married before the first child's born, all married to some goofy dude. I hate to say it, ladies, but if he finds a younger brunette, run. Just saying. So this may not play out very well. So Nick is a stay-at-home dad, and he says that his wives really like to work so he can sit home and think. Yes, he claims that it's his wives' choice because there aren't enough people in the world who are thinking and feeling. I get false guru vibes. I'm not gonna lie, I get false guru vibes. But they get Vera a little baby doll, and the cashier's like, are you all together? And they're like, yeah. And this cashier seems kind of uncomfortable, and he even admits that, you know, they usually just get traditional families coming in here. And he's like, oh yeah, and he makes like the awkward small talk, like, I'm from a big family too. This is not a big family. It is three women, one man, and a baby. Like, this isn't that big of a family. But on the couch, April says, ideally, she wants 4 to 5. Total sister wives. And Danielle gets really flustered and uncomfortable. She looks like she's about to start crying. Like, she's like, I can't imagine finding someone else that seems really compatible. This seems really difficult. And I really am still unable to stop drawing parallels between the Brown family and this family. Because April's like, I want to bring in more people to keep Nick happy. Jennifer's very quiet and reserved. She sits back. She's very quiet. And Danielle seems quite against the addition of more and more and happy to be the final wife. We've seen this before. But we can't deny how this feels very early sister wives. Though they are significantly more stable than the other returning family, for sure. Literally everyone is super uncomfortable, though, when Danielle tries to give off her explanation. And she just, oh, poor thing. But they have bought a home altogether, and they have a 12-foot-wide bed. I would love a 12-foot-wide bed. I would love a room that could house a 12-foot-wide bed. Just saying. And Nick admits that sharing the same bed is uncommon in most plural relationships, but April's like, we've made this choice because we didn't divide our time with Nick. We wanted everybody to be together. And they have, Jennifer's like, we have room, plus a little extra, because you never know what might happen. And Danielle looks like she's about to burst into tears. She is really struggling with the idea of adding more wives into this family. And I think she is really, really uncomfortable. Really uncomfortable with the idea that they would ask her to legally marry the next wife. I can't say for sure yet, but she seems to really shy away when April brings up the plan. They point out that they have separate rooms for intimate activities, which Nick calls the Boom Boom Room. And Danielle hates that name. She would prefer to call it the intimate room, and everyone else is perfectly fine with boom boom room. Nick is like, as far as intimate attention, it's like the planets operating around the sun. Ah, we've heard this before too. And so he says, they don't all receive the same sunlight as each other, but they get what they need while they're in orbit. Which is a little weird, but they bring up the plan of marrying again, and they're like, we need to find a wife for Danielle, because it's been 2 years. And Danielle voices what sounds like a very rehearsed monologue about having just gotten married and just having Vera, and she would really like to enjoy being a first-time wife and mom for a little bit and doesn't understand the need to rush into dating. And then there is just uncomfortable silence from everyone, and the first three look into the camera very upset. And that's where it cuts. I don't think this is going to work out very well, and I feel like we're going to get some blow-ups from Danielle and possibly the rest of the family as this season goes on. Now on to the significantly less stable Merrifields. I stopped watching this show after the second season, but I know Garrick and Danielle's story, so the Merrifields are back, and Danielle is still one of the weirdest people I have ever seen on reality television. Okay? Because Garrick is odd, but she just, I don't know. And it would really help them to admit that Garrick just has a thing for Brazilian women, honestly, because they are pursuing another international polygamous union. Listen, we all know that these folks are well known to be a hot mess. If you haven't even watched the show, you have probably heard about Garrick and Danielle and Roberta. It is a mess. And these two are super awkward. They have no chemistry. There is no dynamic here that I can understand. They say they've been living polygamy for 5 years, but they haven't really ever had a second wife. They're the only family on this season that I would say is living some sort of Christian polygamous religious polygamy. And I say it that way because obviously one of the pillars of Islam is polygamy. Generally speaking, Christianity, not a pillar. Not a pillar. And so they are trying to explain it. And I am so uncomfortable with the things Garrick says. Firstly, everything he says is super blasphemous. And especially claiming that the Holy Ghost is something sexual. Y'all, I'm a Christian. I'm not signing off on anything this man says, and I'm not here to Bible beat or bash anybody, but this is wrong and kind of evil the way that he says these things. I don't get it. These two make me super angry, but Danielle even looks pained as Garrick is trying to convince us that the Holy Ghost is equated to sperm lodged in the brain of a woman, and that women cannot transfer their DNA to men, only the other way around, and that's why it's this polygamy is the exact same thing as giving your life to Jesus. I can't even believe I said those words. I hope I don't believe that. Like, I just don't. I can't. I have zero idea how Danielle believes this, and frankly, I don't think that she does. The look on her face does not convince me that she is on his side. I don't know. But Garrick just seems like he wants to be the least successful cult leader to exist, I'm being honest. And when he tries to compare everything to Christ, Danielle stops touching him and just sort of gives him this weird, creepy smile. Like, I don't get it. I don't get it. So they just start discussing their failed courtship and their probably fraudulent divorce involving Roberta. And their entire plan was to bring Roberta here on a fiancé visa, which is super illegal because you are not legally allowed to bring somebody on a fiancé visa for the purpose of living polygamy. And they did it on television. I don't get it. I don't understand how they got this visa. But Danielle clearly struggled with this divorce a lot. Like, a lot. Because they had mentioned, she mentions, they had considered divorcing multiple times for real. And Garrick's, like, totally unfazed by all of it. Like, he just does not seem to care about anything. And Danielle's like, listen, Roberta had said to me once that she hoped she would be the only sister wife. It would just be her and Danielle. So knowing that, they chose to date somebody else and then got really ticked off at Roberta because Danielle says that clearly violating Roberta's boundaries and Roberta having feelings about the clear violations of her boundaries made her apprehensive that Roberta didn't really want this. Okay, maybe that was a little bit of me putting my own spin on what she said, but close enough. She claims other people were super skeptical too. They show clips of the Danielle fake scream crying. If y'all haven't seen this, please go find it. She is like fake scream crying when Roberta says she's not coming. And they completely cut off contact since then. Garrick equates it to a death. Basically, she's dead to them. All right, then. But he does share that his pastor encouraged him to move on and quit bellyaching and quit crying over spilled milk. I am curious, because no Christian pastor that I know would ever advocate for someone having a second wife, let alone telling them to move on and keep trying. I don't know. They're going through boxes and they're going to throw away a bunch of stuff that they had gotten for Roberta since she isn't coming. And Garrick's like, I'm ready to start dating again right away. And Danielle is super apprehensive. But now they've met Natalia. And hopefully what I'm about to say comes off as intended. But it is crazy to me that Garrick portrays himself as this very buttoned up, upright religious figure. But he is out here specifically picking women who don't necessarily seem to embody those same moral elements that Garrick espouses. Obviously, people can dress the way they want. They can look the way they want. I'm not out here telling anybody how they can dress or can't dress. But Garrick kind of portrays himself in a very particular light. And the women he chooses don't seem to fall in that same vein. I'm fine with whatever people want to do. I may not do it, but you can. I don't care. But he is also out here sleeping with women he's not married to and trying to pass it off as some sort of spiritual religious experience. And I'm kind of offended by that. You don't play these games. And he's going to get called out for it. Don't worry. Natalia's 26 and they've been talking for about 4.5 months. And apparently 2 months in, things started getting very serious. They've been putting off telling family about dating Natalia. And I think for a very good reason. But now they're going to share with Sam and Samantha. Sam is Danielle's brother. Samantha is his wife. But Danielle and Garrick are both super nervous about how this is going to go. The interaction that these two are having, even discussing this situation, is super awkward and stilted. It feels very alien. There's no chemistry here. Danielle shares that she and Garrick are usually on the same page. And I don't know how, because they seem like two people who've never met before. But she's been having fears that they are moving way too fast. Alone in her interview, Danielle seems sort of beaten down. Like, she doesn't really want to be doing this, but they're invested. So Samantha comes over to help garden, and Danielle's super nervous to talk to her about dating again. Partly because she's nervous herself about the speed at which things are going. And she appreciates Samantha's advice, so this is super important to her to tell her. Garrick, on the other hand, goes to speak with Sam, who is his partner in the construction company they both own. And Garrick's coming to check on a project for a client, and thinks this is a great time to tell him about it. It looks like Sam is more of the blue-collar, hands-on construction-y guy, where Garrick seems to be more of the white-collar, behind-the-desk, working-with-clients kind of guy. So Danielle sort of eases into the conversation by asking Samantha, so how are you and Sam? And when Samantha returns the question, she's like, well, we're dating again. And Samantha literally freezes in her tracks. She is bent over doing something, and she freezes. You can, like, see her whole body tense. And then she just sort of stares at Danielle. On the other side of the conversation, Garrick just blurts it out, and Sam seems equally shocked. And Samantha's like, where's this young lady from? And Danielle kind of just laughs nervously, and she's like, Rio, the same place as Roberta? Samantha cannot stop herself from just blurting out, are you kidding me? It is obvious to Danielle that Samantha is not on board with this, and Sam is significantly more vocal when he tells Garrick to his face that he is crazy. He says Garrick is out of his mind, and he is just worried history is repeating itself. And that was the first episode. There is actually still a family we haven't met yet, the Ryan family, who come from Texas. I don't know. I don't know. These people all seem a little wild. I feel like I'll make some predictions since we've seen this bit now. I feel like Naeem and Nyla have a 50-50 shot at having something work out. It's very 50-50 to me. I think you have to find somebody who follows a similar belief pattern, not the same necessarily, but a similar one, in order to kind of understand each other where you're coming from. I don't think that's going to work out for the Sherwoods at all. I think either they're just not going to be able to do it, or Ashley and Shane will probably split up. I think that the Merrifields are going to crash and burn again because they're following the exact same pattern that they did last time. And I think the Davises, at the bare minimum, the first and second wife and Nick will probably be fine. But I think it's very possible Danielle will decide that this isn't for her, which is, you know, fair and a little unfortunate, I suppose. But that's really all I've got for you guys about this first episode of Seeking Sister Wife. What do we think? Is it worth watching? If it's not worth watching, do you just want to hear me talk about it? Because I'm fine with that. Like I said, I really do want to do a rewatch of My Five Wives. I actually kind of really like that show. I think it's a little bit different, a little less dramatic, and so it can be a good watch. But I'm also interested. Are there other shows you guys want to hear about? Are there other shows we should be watching? What do you guys think? So yeah, let me know down in the comments. If you like this, feel free to give it a like. If you want to subscribe and see what's going on, feel free to subscribe. I've been putting out some shorts about the silly things that Graham does. At some point, we will be doing a definite temperature blanket update. We are partially caught up because Joanne's didn't want to ship me my yarn for the 70 degree days that we had randomly. It showed up finally, don't worry. I finally have it, but I'm not caught up yet. So yeah, I can't wait to hear from you guys. I will see you down in the comments below. And until then, I'll talk to you soon. Bye.